Okay, meanwhile, let me just give few tips about the exam. So an important thing is that in the ATX exam is that number one is students should try to complete the 100% paper. That means all four questions they have tried to attempt at least, and try to manage the time in such a way that you do not give much time to one question, specifically the section A, the 35 marks question. That takes too much time, and a student normally spend more than 1 hour, like 1.5 hour on this question. So as a result, they are not able to attempt the rest of the question effectively. This is number one tip. Next thing is that, as you can see here, we have four questions, two from section A and two from section B. So it's always advisable to start from section B first. Section B questions are easy in terms of the information given in the question. The information is limited. The question's requirement is also very limited. So it's better to complete the section B first. Section B comprises of 220 mark questions. So we have 40 marks. And for 40 marks, we have to approximately spend around 1 hour. So within 1 hour, we have to complete the entire section B. If one or two areas are difficult, then you can skip for that areas, and rest you can attempt all the areas, especially the theoretical one, which is easy. If you know the tax rule, then theoretical one is easy, and calculation is depends. So once you cover the section B type question, then you have to start from section A. And section A first question worth 35 marks, containing too much information. Section A second question worth 25 marks, bit less information. So better to start with question number two, and then left enough time for the question number one, so that at least the entire paper can be touched, entire paper can be attempted. Usually it happens that students are not able to attempt more than 80% marks, and that's create a problem for getting passing marks. Like if they are attempting 80% paper only and getting 40 plus marks, then if they attempt the entire paper, they can easily score the passing marks. Now, this is our platform, the kind of the actual exam. And we have here, I have taken this question number four or three from the section B, a typical 20 mark question. So we'll go through all the questions in this particular practice exam too on the ACCA CB platform. And let's see what are the difficult areas, which questions we have to attempt first. We have to plan. Basically, I'm trying to give you an idea how to plan your 3 hours. An important thing is that that for calculation, if there is a flat calculation requirement, then it's better to use a spreadsheet. If there is a flat theory question, it is better to use the word processor. And obviously, in question number one, we have to create a format. We have to produce a format. So the section A35 mark question always have on word processor. And in between whatever calculation we have to perform, we can attach that calculation too. Third type of question that we have to deal with, like the second question here, explain with supporting calculation. So if there are minor calculation, there is no need to use the Excel spreadsheet. Just do it in the word processor and use one document for one requirement. Alternatively, whatever response option you can use, but use spreadsheet for calculation and word processor for the theory. Now, this is question number four. This is question number three or four from section B. Let's start with this. Let's identify, is that easy question or difficult one? How much theory, how much calculation? Should we attempt this question entirely or should left with some parts? Let's begin with this. So it says that question three or four, first part A1, this is the requirement, but I have to go to scenario first. and then see the requirement. Meantime, let me see the requirement. First requirement says that explain with supporting calculations the capital gain tax implication for LIBOR of the takeover of Vulcan Limited by Mercury PLC on 1st June 2022 and on subsequent sale of his Mercury PLC shares on 1st January 2023. So basically, it's a disposal of shares by a company. So basically, it's related with CGT of a company. And obviously, we need to find out the gain or loss on disposal. So we have to keep in mind that what is the process of calculation of gain or loss for a company, number one. And the second thing is that these shares are acquired on the basis of a takeover. So we have to see what are the terms and conditions of the takeover. The second part says that explain with supporting calculation again, why it would be beneficial for LIBOR to sell his shares on 1st May 2023 rather than on 1st January 2023. So here clearly there is a clue that if you sell shares in May 2023, so that falls in like 23-24. And if you sell on 1st January 23, it falls in 22-23. So if you want to get the benefits of another annual exemption, just delay the timing of your disposal of shares and get one additional annual exemption. So this part is related with that. In the third part, advise the company, advise Vesta whether or not there are any capital gain tax or inheritance tax advantages for herself. Now this is a flat seems to be a theoretical questions for herself or for Janice if she were to give the investment property on 31st December rather than leaving it to him in her estate on death. So this is about the benefits of a lifetime gift versus the gift or the amount left in the death state. So it's a planning question about CHT, CGT planning or about IHT planning. So not a difficult question in terms of the topics, that is CGT and IHT. So mainly the question comprises of CGT. Now see the scenario. What scenario says? So scenario says that LIBOR proposed transaction in Mercury PLC shares. LIBOR now wishes to sell all of his shares that he acquired in Mercury PLC. He has received an offer from an unconnected person to purchase these shares on 1st January at a price of 28 per share. LIBOR would prefer to sell the shares to his nephew. However, this would delay the sale as his nephew will not have the necessary funds to purchase the shares until 1st May 2023. So there are two things. One is the disposal of shares on 1st January to an unconnected person at a price of 28 per share. And second, to delay the sale, sell it to a connected person, right? And the price will be 28 per share. Remember that if you sell below the market price, so it might be a thing like sale at undervalue and then gift relief might be possible for an individual, not for the company. Because reliefs are available for the case of an individual CGT, and for corporation, there is only one relief available, that is called ROR. Moving forward. So another requirement is Vesta is 66 years old and has never married or had a civil partner, is in ill health and is expected to die at some time within the tax year 23-24. He has made no disposal for CGT purpose in the tax year to date and will not make any in the tax year 23-24. These are the two things. Has made one previous lifetime gifts of 3,50,000 to her son Janice on 1st June 2022. Now, as far as investment property is concerned, Vesta owns an investment property which has never been used as her main residence. So if there is a property that has never been used as a main residence, then we will not get any exemption, not get any kind of like PRR. The current market value of property is less than the price Vesta paid for it. and its value is expected to fall. This is an important point. A property whose value is going to fall in future, Vesta is considering gifting the property to Janus in her lifetime rather than leaving it to him in the death state. Janus is the sole beneficiary of Vesta's estate. So, as far as the lifetime versus death is concerned, we know that the benefit of giving lifetime gift is that in this case, this becomes the potentially exempt transfer, and potentially exempt transfer is not taxable in the year of gift. And if donor die within 7 years, then it is taxable. But if donor survive 7 years, then again, it is not taxable at all. And even if the donor die within 7 years, there is a kind of taper relief available to get the benefit of minimum 20% and maximum 80% taper relief benefits. And if, like in case of a potentially exempt transfer, if the asset is of such kind that there is a fall in the value, then you will get the fall in value relief as well. So these are the few benefits which we can write in the third part. Now, as far as the disposal of shares is concerned, so let's see the information. LIBOR is UK resident in domicile, taxable income of 30,000 each year. LIBOR acquisition of ordinary shares in Mercury PLC. So originally LIBOR acquire these 800 ordinary shares, 40% holding in Vulcan Limited for 14,000. So 14,000 is the original cost. And we have 800 shares. Now, when Mercury PLC acquired Vulcan Limited on 1st June, there will be an exchange of shares and cash, right? And we know that in the case of cash consideration, this is a disposal and we have to calculate the CGT. But problem is that we have to split this 14,000 cost among the value of shares and the value of cash. So what exchange offer has been given? In exchange for each share in Vulcan Limited, which is 800, you'll receive 4 ordinary shares in Mercury PLC, valued at 20 per share. So if I need to calculate this, I can put here like existing shares. So how many existing shares? 800. And the offer, how much cash is available, how much shares are available. So I will get what I will get. I will get 4 ordinary shares and the value is 20. So 4 ordinary shares and value is 20. So that means 800 shares I have multiplied by 4. This is the total number of shares and the value is 20. So that is the total worth of shares. And as far as cash is concerned, and 15 pound cash per ordinary shares. So the cash value is 15 and the number of shares are 800. So these are the two values. And the total is 76,000. Why I have calculated these? Because then I have to split the cost into cash component and into shares component. So the cost was 14,000. This is the 14,000. I need to multiply this by the cash component, which is this one, the cash component. Okay, let me rework here. So 14,000 is the cost and I need to use the cash component, divide this cash component with this total, and this will allocate the cost. That is, let me check whether it's correct. 14,000 into 12,000 divided by 76,000. So the value is 2,210. And this, as far as this shares is concerned, this total cost 14,000 minus this cost, we will get the leftover shares. This will help me to calculate the gain on loss on disposal. So this is cash received, and the cash received is how much cash received we have. So cash received, we have 12,000 cash received. And what is the cost? Cost I have calculated. This is my cost. And as a result, there is a gain, and we can calculate this gain here. We can calculate this is basically the gain as a result of cash component. So moving forward, see the requirement. So in first part, we have to calculate the gain against cash consideration, and then we have to calculate gain again on the subsequent sale of the shares. We will get easy 8 marks out of here. And then we have to discuss theory that if I delay this transaction, as a result, I will get another annual exemption that will reduce my tax liability. And in the third part, I told you that you have to give the benefits of lifetime gifts versus the death state. So this is an overview of this question. Not that difficult, kind of a decent question that that can be easily attempted by any student. Let's move to question number 4. Now the same thing, what I'm doing, as per my planning, I'm working with section B first. And I know that for these 40 marks, how many minutes I have, I need to calculate, and I have to complete, I have to wrap up as soon as possible. Especially theory, I need to carefully work theory. So within an hour means 60 minutes is quite enough for that section B question. If you stuck up in any part, then just leave it and move on to other question. Now another question, section B. So we have a scenario, we have a requirement. If you see requirement, there are few requirements. First is about explain the extent to which the receipt of 20,000 lump sum payment and the relocation package in relation to Demeter's move to London will give rise to taxable employment income. This is related to employment income. And then the other one is about chargeable gain. The third one is about the pension scheme. And the fourth one is about non-advantageous share option scheme, again related with the employment income. So this is basically merely an income tax topic. If you go with the scenario, and let's elaborate a bit, keeping in mind that in what time I need to complete this question. Meanwhile, let's open this question and then we will discuss. Now see, we have Demeter is UK resident and domicile, commence employment with P Limited on 1st December 2022, that is in between the tax year, will have no source of income other than this, will be a higher rate taxpayer, has relocated to London from Manchester, a city more than 150 miles north of London to take up his employment. So might be relocation benefits will be given. As far as remuneration expense is concerned, annual salary is 2,20,000. 1st December, P Limited made a one-off lump sum payment of 20,000 as an inducement to take up employment with the company. This particular amount is fully taxable as it relates to future employment. So as paid December 5,000 towards his cost of relocation to London and also paying him 1,500 each month for 4 months from 1st December towards renting accommodation until he purchases a new house. So 5,000 payment relocation and 1,500 into 4 That means 6,000 plus 5,000, total 11,000 given to him. And shares were granted to him against a non-tax advantageous share option scheme. And he also participated in occupational pension scheme. Now, Demeter incurred costs in relation to his relocation, 6,000. This amount includes estate agent fee of 2,800 and also signed a 4-month lease for a flat in London at a monthly rental of 1,700. Something about his house in Manchester. Demeter purchased the house on 1st Feb 2010 and lived in it as his main residence. So this is about our six-mark question. Let's discuss this part B. Identify and calculate with brief explanation the reliefs available to Demeter to reduce the chargeable gain of 94,000 on disposal of shares. So now, identify and calculate. So basically, spreadsheet is not 100% relevant. Here I have to use this. That what would be my response sheet for this relief? How much relief will be available? What kind of relief will be available? If any major working I have to done in the as a calculation, I will show it in Excel, or I can directly show it here. So moving forward, the scenario. The date of acquisition is 1st Feb 2010. This is a main residence, so PRR relief is available. Demeter let the top floor of the house comprising 30% of the total house to tenants from 1st Feb 2012 to 31st October. The tenant did not share the living accommodation or take meals with him. Demeter continued to occupy the remainder as his main residence until 31st October when the entire house was sold. The sale gave rise to a gain of 94,000. Demeter did not own any other house throughout the period. So it's about we have to talk about here that this particular house is basically as it is an own residence, main residence. So PRR will be available and PRR will exempt the gain for which actual or deemed occupation was available. And we need to work out, first of all, the availability of PRR and availability of letting relief. So we need to do some working. So for PRR working, it's better to use the Excel here. So what is the date of occupation? The date of occupation is from 1st Feb 2010. So from 1st Feb 2010, 1st Feb 2010, from this date, we need to assess. How much is the time? From 1st Feb 2010 till 1st Feb 2012. Then on 1st Feb 2012, he rented out. So basically, we have some part is 100% occupied. 1st Feb 2010 and 1st Feb 2012. So, 1st Feb 2012. And then let's count that how many months we have. Basically, there are 24 months. This is basically actual occupation. And then from 1st Feb 2012 to 31st October 2022, when he sold that house, so 1st Feb 2012 to 22. We have to separate out last 9 months as well. So what we do is from 1st Feb 2012 to 31st October 2022. So here we can write exempt one. Here we can write chargeable. So first Feb 2012 to 30th October 2022. Now, if you count this period, it's around approximately more than 10 years. So from 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, it's complete 10 years till 1st Feb, and then Feb, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, and then 9 months. So last 9 months is always unconditionally claimed as actual occupation. So it's 10 years and 9 months. Now, 9 months I have separated. Now let's talk about 10 years. So let's do it here. Last 9 months. Let me separate out this last 9 months. And then I have to use this 10 years. And 10 years means, 10 years means I have 120 months. 120 months. So if it is 10 years, if I'm correct, then the 70% of that is on occupation. The 70% is on occupation, 84 months, and the rest is on letting period. So the total period, total, here we can use the 120 months into 0.3 is 36. So that means the chargeable period is 24 months plus 84 plus 9. This is chargeable. And this is, sorry, exempt. This is chargeable, 36. So we have total. Total becomes 117 and 36. It's 117 plus 36. This is 153. So what you have to do, you have to calculate PRR. And PRR is basically gain. Gain has been given as 94,000. It's 94,000. Multiply by the period of occupation, which we have, which I have calculated roughly, not exactly 100%. And total is 153. So this is what you can easily find out, that how much PRR is available. And important thing is that here we have letting period, and the letting period also enjoyed with occupation. So then LR relief is also available. We need to work out LR as well. So we have to calculate letting relief as well. And the letting relief is lower of the amount which is fixed, that is 40,000. The amount of PRR, which is above 71882, and gain relates to letting. Gain relates to letting. Gain relates to letting. And this, how we can calculate? We have to calculate this by the amount of gain, which is 94,000, multiply by the period, which is period, that is 36 months, divided by total period, that is 153, I guess. And this is 22,117. So in this way, we have PRR available, we have letting available, and from the 94,000 gain, we can easily deduct. Now see, identify and calculate with brief explanation the relief available to reduce the chargeable gain. So now you can write here the response. The possible reliefs available are PRR and letting relief. So PRR is available against actual and deemed occupation, while LR is available if the house was let out along with period of occupation. Now then you have to explain that how much PRR is available with the working. PRR is available. Now you can refer here, see Excel working. You can refer Excel working, and then LR is available. You can show working here as well directly. See Excel working. Both options are available, whatever is convenient. In this way, you can explain the theory as well as the calculation part. Now, as far as the pension scheme is concerned, something about pension scheme. Demeter has made tax allowable contribution of 40,000 to a personal pension plan for the last 5 tax years and will continue to do so in future. So every year he is contributing 40,000. From the tax year 23-24, will contribute an amount equal to 10% of annual salary to its approved occupation pension scheme. Demeter will make no contribution to occupational scheme. That means employer is not paying anything against this. A simple requirement is that explain with supporting calculation the tax consequences of participating in occupational pension scheme. Now we know that occupational pension scheme will give us something like if some employee is participating in the occupational pension scheme, then the employer contribution is an exempt benefit and employee contribution is deductible against the salary. And this employer contribution add with the personal contribution, and we have to compare this against annual allowance, and we have to see whether my annual allowance will be reduced or not. And if my contribution is exceeding the annual allowance, which is 40,000 fixed, and the unused annual allowance brought forward, then I have to pay annual allowance charge, which is a non-saving income, and I have to pay at the end of all other things. So this is the kind of bit calculation and numerical. We can write something here. So this is a brief overview of question number 2. Now let's focus on section A. Here we have, I told you that start from section question 2 of this. We'll go with this one. Now, 25 mark question. We have one attachment, we have two attachment, we have extract of email, lots of information. See first the requirement. There's no direct requirement available. It is about relief for the capital loss and not much. Third thing is about The VAT on the sale of the building, 6 marks. We need to see the piece attachment, the extracts of the email manager. See the extract. Let me open the structure as well. It's Eat Limited. Some information about Eat Limited. Let's see the extract, the manager's extract. So in section B, usually the majority of the parts are quite easy. So instead of deafening any part, it's better to try all the parts, especially theory one. Now let's see the information. Now in the email, please carry out the following tasks. So these are the actual requirement. Identify with supporting explanation those companies to which the capital loss on the sale of the building could be transferred such that the group's cash flow position would be improved. Now this indicate me that it is a, they are talking about the 75% gain group. We can use the capital loss to be transferred. Note all of the companies in the group apart from Flip Limited are required to pay corporation tax in quarterly installments. This will be true regardless of how the capital loss is reviewed. So, for example, if you have a company which is paying quarterly installment, that means it's a large company. So the thing is that we know that why it has become a large company, because its augmented profit has been more than the profit threshold. So if you reduce the augmented profit by transferring the capital loss to be offset against the capital gain, then there is a possibility that this large company becomes a small company and you will get some benefit of late payment of tax. On the assumption that the whole of the capital loss is transferred to Jack Limited, calculate the quarterly payment of corporate tax due on 14 January from that company. Please carry out this calculation. Note one, on each installment payment date, each group company pays the amount of tax necessary in order to ensure that it has paid the correct total amount based on budgeted figure. Explain the potential advantages of entering into group payment arrangement for corporation tax purpose. So first one is about the gain group, the transfer of losses like that. And the second one is about, in response to acquisition of 60% shares of LodgeCo, explain why LodgeCo will be a controlled foreign company, a kind of a regular question that you need to identify why a company called CFC, explain how any CFC charge would be calculated, state the condition which need to be met in order for the 12-month exempt period. Now, these three parts are quite easy to handle. And the requirement says that it worth 8 marks. I have to start from this. This is an easy marks as compared to the part A. And the CFC is always examinable topic. As far as the VAT is concerned, the group finance director is considering whether or not to opt to tax regard with building in respect of the two alternatives. Explain whether or not VAT should be charged on the sale of the building. Calculate the final adjustment which will be made under the capital goods scheme. Now, this is a bit tricky area if not covered effectively. So, means most of the marks are available, like 11 marks against the capital gain group and large company CFC. So, 19 marks are quite handy here that we can easily target. So, now I'll look for the attachment one. See the composition of the group, because we know that a capital gain group is one where a parent hold at least 75% shares directly and indirectly more than 51% shares. See, let me identify. Eat Limited has 100% shares in Flip Limited and 65% shares in Ghost Limited and 100% in Hen Limited, 80% in Jack Limited. Hen Limited in turns acquire 60% in Eid Limited. Czech Limited in turns required 75% shares in Kits Limited. All seven companies are UK resident companies. Flip Limited was incorporated and began trading on 1st December 2022. There have been no other changes to the ownership. Now, very flat, very easy question in terms of group structure. But the concept must be very clear that which company we can made into this 75% gain group. If a student know the concept, if a student knows the difference between a 75% group loss relief group and a 75% capital gain group, then student can easily understand this and can score the marks. And it is also a very, very examinable topic in exam two. So see, Eat Limited, one company, Flip Limited is a part of the group. Ghost Limited, just eliminate this. Hand Limited, yes. Jack Limited, yes. And in turn, 60 into 100, so more than 51, yes. And 75 into 80. Now this I need to check whether 75% of the 80% becomes more than 51. If yes, then I'll make it like 75 into 0.8. So this is 60. Okay, then it's very clear that Eat Limited has Flip Limited, Hand Limited, Jack Limited, Eid Limited, Kids Limited. All except for GOS. These are the 75% gain group companies. So we can easily transfer losses in between. So I'll again move to the requirement that first one, very clear, identify with supporting explanation those companies to which the capital loss on the sale of the building would be transferred such that the group's cash flow would be improved. So from the cash flow point of view, it's better to transfer to those companies that have the, see the attachment to first, see the position of their profit. So budgeted results, Eat Limited, which is the parent company, Eat Limited has chargeable gain, no chargeable gain. Flip Limited has chargeable gain. Ghost Limited, irrelevant. Hand Limited, no chargeable gain. Eid Limited, Jack Limited, and Kid Limited. So to whom we have capital losses. So on 2nd December 2022, Hen Limited sold the PO building. This sale resulted in a capital loss of 80,000 as loss is not reflected in the above figures. Now see, Hen Limited has no capital gain available. So Hen Limited cannot offset loss here. So it's better to use the other companies in such a way that your profit threshold, you should know that what is my profit threshold available and how we can calculate profit threshold. That is interesting. Profit threshold is for every company. This is a taxable total profit plus dividend. If there is no dividend, then this taxable total profit. And then we need to identify the companies, the 51% companies. So in this example, we have to calculate profit threshold as well. Identify, compare which one is the large company and then transfer to those companies that we can convert from a loss, a large company to a small company. Now see, Kid Limited having good handsome income, Jack Limited, Eid Limited. So like every company has something to. Now rollover relief will not be claimed against any group company's chargeable gain. So simply, let me refer it back to again the requirement. So in the first one, what I need to do? In the first one, I need to identify the 75% company. I need to identify the augmented profit. And on the assumption that the whole of the capital loss is transferred to Jack Limited. In the first part, we have to identify. In the second part, if we transfer to Jack Limited, calculate the quarterly payment for corporate tax due on 14 January 2023 for that company. That means the installment. We have to find out the installment. Right? So this is a basic discussion about this particular question. And now the last one. That is a huge one. Let's see what topics are there, how we can plan. And in the exam, the exact amount of time that I need to spend on this question, because I have tried to use the last available time for that. So I need to spend at least 1 hour. So I have to keep my 1 hour, at least 1 hour or 10 minutes before this question. Like in 2 hours, at least I have to attempt section B, 2 questions, and section A, question number 2, and then wait for the things in that question. The question. Again, the same thing. If you open directly the requirement of the question, it says that prepare the notes for use in a meeting with Wanda as requested in the email from your manager. The following marks are available. Now see, professional marks will be awarded for the approach taken to problem solving, the clarity of the explanation and calculation, the effectiveness with which the information is communicated, and overall presentation and style of the note. So these 4 marks is for a proper format, a proper layout, correct calculation, legible calculation, the use of the word processor in an effective way, you can get maximum out of it. And 1 5-part, 5-mark question belongs to ethics. So I think B part, income tax refund, refers to this ethics part. Okay. So first one is Wanda's post-tax inheritance from Lucy, voluntary registration VAT, choice of business structure, income tax and corporation tax payable, and other matters. See the details further. Wanda intends to start a new business, AS, selling children clothes. This business will be partly financed by an inheritance, which Wanda will receive following the recent death of her mother. Wanda's husband will also be involved in the business. Wanda has not been employed since 31st December 16, has not received any taxable income after that. Roth is employed and earns a gross salary of 95,000 per annum. The salary is only one source of income. Both have not made any chargeable disposal of the tax and will not make any further in 23-24. Means the exemption is completely available. The band is completely available for them. Now, the first question was about the inheritance. Let's see this information here. On 1st Feb 2017, Wanda's father died. He left 160 to Wanda and the residue of his estate to his wife, Lucy, which is her mother. The residue of Pavel's estate was valued at 7,20,000 and included the family home. He has not made any gift during his life. On 1st April, Lucy gives Wanda 1,80,000 in cash. This was the only lifetime gift Lucy was made. On 1st November, when Lucy died, Wanda inherited the whole of the estate, which was valued at 9,50,000. Now again, see the requirement. Wanda's post-tax inheritance from Lucy. So it's about death inheritance. So post-tax inheritance. So 9,50,000 was a death estate value. The death estate consisted of the family home valued at 4,40,000, and this has been given to the direct descendants. So R&RB will be available too. And this includes furniture, cash and quoted shares valued at 5,10,000. So keeping in mind the death estate pro forma, if I need to calculate that estates here. After tax, so first I need to calculate the death estate pro forma. So its value has been given in the question. Value has been given as 9,50,000. So it's the value is 9,50,000. And now from this value, we deduct usually inter-spouse. So there is no inter-spouse available here. So as a result, now I need to deduct RNRB if this is available. And I need to deduct the NRB, whatever is available. After deducting this, I'll get the taxable amount. And there is no charity. So tax is 40%. 40% is the tax. And this is kind of working. and whatever he is receiving. So benefits, here are the benefits minus tax. So this is after tax benefits. This working you can connect with the your spreadsheet. Basically, this is requirement number one, A, 6 marks. And as far as the other part is concerned, let's talk about the registration of VAT, the voluntary registration. So we need to understand the business mechanism first. If has been mentioned, and we know that for those businesses having like they want to claim their input as early as possible, it is always beneficial to go for voluntary registration. If they are not selling to direct consumer, they can still get the voluntary registration as well. Easy marks. Now, new business. Wanda intends to begin trading on 1st April 23. The business will be operated via partnership business or via limited liability company in which Wanda and husband is having ownership. The turnover of the business for the year ended March is expected to be 48,000. Now, the turnover limit for VAT registration is 85,000 pounds. So there is no need for compulsory VAT registration. But why there is optional registration beneficial for? So in its first year of trading, the business will make either a small profit or possibly a loss, not more than 20,000. However, once the business is fully operational, it is budgeted to make a tax-adjusted trading profit of 100,000 per annum. And this figure is before deducting any salaries paid to Wanda and R. Now see, if they want to create a partnership business, one benefit is that if there is a loss in the first year, then for sole trader or partnership, we can claim special opening year loss relief. From the last three tax years, we can get benefit. But if we registered as a company, this special opening year loss relief is not available at all. Then we have to go for the other options. Okay, the manner in which the profits will be extracted from the business depends on whether the business is operated as a partnership or a liability company. The two alternatives are given below. So if this registered as a partnership, the salary will be 14,000 and zero. Profit sharing will be 60-40. There will be no dividend. And if it is a company, then Wanda will get salary of 42,000, Roth 32,000. Then dividend will be 14,000 and 6,000. So each as an individual will be liable to pay tax on dividend. In addition to advising her on the tax cost of the alternate business structure, Wanda has asked us to advise on the relief available against possible trading loss in the first year of trading and on the choice of 31st March as the accounting date when the business is operated as a partnership. Now, this is also connected with the basis period computation as well. Now, next is, Wanda has refunded an unexpected refund of income tax from HM Revenue Custom in respect of the tax year 15-16. Unexpected refund she got. So if she got an unexpected refund, so it means that, now see, here the VAT registration is concerned. The sale of children's cloth is a zero-rated supply for the purpose of VAT. With this is mine, explain why the business would be permitted to register for VAT from 1st April and the advantages in this very, very easy 4 marks. Why the business is permitted? Because like business is trying to get some voluntary registration. The benefits are that we are selling a zero-rated supply. No need to pay output tax, but we can claim input tax from the business date as well as the pre-trading rule. And disadvantage is that, what is the disadvantage? Some administration burden we have to bear with registration. This is the disadvantage. Now, as far as choice of business structure is concerned, you can see here, for a single tax year, calculate the income tax payable by both by R as a partner and an incorporation tax payable if the business is operated as a partnership, if the business is operated as a company. Prepare a summary of the total tax payable if bonders, income tax liabilities are business operated as a partnership. As a company, you should assume that the business is fully operational and makes a tax adjusted profit of 100,000 like this. So this is the complete income tax and corporation tax type question. And other matters, what we have, compare the tax relief available to Wanda and Roth in respect of a trading loss arising in the first year of trading, depending on whether the business is operated as a partnership or as a company. On the assumption that the business is always profitable and is operated as a partnership, explain two advantages of having an accounting date of 30th June. So benefits of a tax year that is different from the accounting year that is different from the tax year. Now, one thing is very easy. If your tax year is 31st March, then you have to pay tax immediately, very soon. But if your tax year is accounting year is 30th June, then first you have to wait till tax year end, and then after the tax year you have to pay. So time delay is available. You will get some benefits of time delay as well as some planning opportunities. So clearly two advantages are there. And loss relief, I told you that a special opening year loss relief is available in case of individual, but not in case of corporation. Income tax refund is concerned, prepare a summary of the action which we should take and the matters of which Wanda should be aware in relation to the income tax refund. Now, this is related with the ethics question, and we have to be ethical, as we know that. So first of all, as we see, the information that what kind of refund we get, for what purpose. Income tax refund. Unexpected refund of income tax from HM Revenue Custom in respect of tax year 15-16. So, from the ethics point of view, it is advisable that you should inform the HM Revenue Custom that this particular amount is not belongs to us, rather than hiding it. So, hiding it will be an unethical activity. You have to see, evaluate whether it's related to you or not. First check by yourself. If it is not taking into consideration all the aspects of this information with you, and then you have to inform HMRC about this, that this refund is not belongs to me, then you can easily achieve the ethics marks. A good question containing lots of information. And see, as it is a Section A type question, so you have to plan from where to start. But as you need to earn this 4 marks, so you have to start it straight from the first one, that is IHT, then VAT, then choice of business structure. And you have to put headings here, like you have to start. So proper heading is there, like first part, like A is post-tax IHT, then B about voluntary registration. And even if you are not writing under the heading of post tax, you want to solve the part B, then you will start writing under voluntary registration that why it is beneficial, what are the advantages and disadvantages, then jump to C part, or you can jump to D part, you can jump to E part, you can solve E part first. Always work with easy marks. Like E part is about the ethics, the refund. Here it's other matters. You have to use subheadings. Here the structure. Use subheadings as well. And try to complete it as per the proper structure. Use the spreadsheet when you need detailed calculation, and then attach the reference like C in the Excel sheet. In this way, there are chances that maximum marks will be available to you.